الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله
أشهد أن محمد رسول
الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله لقد جاءت رسل ربنا بالحق سبحانك يا ربنا لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك نستغفرك ونتوب إليك وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت وهو حي لا يموت بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله خير نبي اصطفاه ورحمة للعالمين أرسله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وأنعم على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا وأصحابه نجوم الدين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين أما بعد عباد الله اتقوا الله يقول الله تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون We as humankind, we are on this earth to be according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala designated to us. We are not by our own. We are here to be guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. وَمَا خَلَقَتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ I haven't created the jinn and the humankind except for worshipping me. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. And the way we should have our relation, find our way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it should come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's impossible to come from us because we are full with all deficiencies. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most knowledgeable, the most wise, the perfect one, is going to give us, is going to grant us with whatever is good for us, not for him subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are not going to reach any point to give benefit to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are not going to reach any point to be harmful to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. We would rather give benefit to ourselves. We would rather hurt ourselves. We are not going to find our real meaning of humanity when we don't go according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instruction. And the best way of this is that holy book, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised when he said, Alhamdulillahi alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitab wa lam yaj'al lahu iwaja. All praises to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who descended on his slave, on his servant, at the book. When you say in Arabic, the book, that means this is the perfect one. This is almost the only one that it deserves to be called book. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describe it after those praises to him subhanahu wa ta'ala, that there is no misguidance, there is no deviation, there is no diverting in this book, you know. And this great book, which was delivered to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, out of the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, still available to us up till now. And we are going to find in it anything you need for any manifestation, any clearance, any knowledge, any thing that you may not do, you may not know, you are going to find it in this holy book, which was described by Allah, tibyanan li kulli shay. Everything is going to be manifested in the Holy Quran. At least, which is one of the most important thing, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want from you? You are here to work according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you. And you as a humankind, you are way down of knowing what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of his mercy, he sent this great messenger, you know, to tell you what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants for you. And this has been summarized in this holy book, you know, in the Holy Quran, which is not that long, you know. When you ask anyone, what do you want from me? He's going to give you a large list, you know, a very long list, you know. And whenever you finish it, he's going to give you another one, a third one, and fourth one, to an endless chain. Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it too easy on you, and we make it in a summary for you to know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you. If I want to be much more thorough about it, you have your outer and inner. The best resource for your outer is Surah Al-Baqarah. Go back and try to behave yourself according to Surah Al-Baqarah. And the best resource to behave yourself from inner is Surah Ali Imran. And that's why Sayyidina Anas Malik, as narrated in Sahihain in Bukhari and Muslim, that whenever the man is going to memorize, and in these old days, these blessed days, the one who memorized Surah Al-Baqarah and Ali Imran, that means he got over all of the commands, all the prohibitions, he practiced them in his life. Whoever memorized Surah Al-Baqarah and Ali Imran, Sayyidina Anas Malik said, he's going to be looked at as a great person in our eyes. And this because he is perfect man. He fixed his outer and his inner according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regulation, according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instruction. This book is great, man. But we find ourselves in many occasions, we are little bit way down. We need some clarification. We need some, let's say, before clarification, you know, you need practice. You have a lot of theories in this life. If you look at the Quran as a theology, it accompanied with the practice of the Prophet ﷺ, which make it much more great. Because here you have a human, bi abi wa ummi, a person who practiced this Quran. And that's why he was described ﷺ as mushaf walking on the ground. Why? And as Sayyidah Aisha, she described him when she was asked about the characters of the Prophet ﷺ, she said his character was the Quran, as narrated in Sahih Muslim. So here, when you have this attached to the theology in the Holy Quran, you have the best thing, you know, of trying to follow the steps. And no one of us has any excuse to say, this is not feasible, this is not impractical, this is of this or that. Because the blessed life, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swear in the Holy Quran by it, لَعَمْرُكَ إِنَّهُمْ لَفِي سَكْرَتِهِمْ يَعْمَهُونَ. I would rather say, Sayyidina Ibn Abbas said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't swear by anyone's life except Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because of this greatness in his life, because of this matching with the Holy Quran, because of this practicality. And I look at the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as The most broad one in its practice. Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has the largest exposure to all events in this life, you know, the happy one and the sad one, the high one and the low one, and you name it. And that by this, we are glorified as a Muslim by having whatever you have any doubt and about any portion in the Quran, whenever you have anything that is not clear in your mind, you have the holy tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is going to be great, you know, because it's going to enlighten, it's going to guide you for many aspects that you will never even imagine. And that's why the scholars, they said many of the warning, they have a linguistic meaning and it has religious meaning. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, wa aqimu salah, if I'm going to sit down, you know, and think for millions of years, I'm not going to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at your people, you know, you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told you, come, not the explicit, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told you, come at this time to the mosque, to listen, to speak up, and then to pray to rak'ahs. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you. And this, if I'm going to sit down, you know, thinking about it millions of years, I'm not going to understand it. And this is what the scholars, they call it mujmal. And many of those mujmalat in the Quran, they have been uncovered, they have been described, they have been manifested, you know, by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his practice and in his statement, in his prophetic statement. That's why he said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. Okay, you are commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to pray. How we are going to pray? He said, follow me, okay, learn from me how to pray. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَاللَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ. How I'm going to perform Hajj, you know, with this long list, you know, and many actions, and what is obligated, and what is prohibited, and this and that. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خُذُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ. Take it from me, okay? And that's the same thing for zakah, same thing for siyam. How to fast, you know, what to refrain, what we are permitted to do, what we are not permitted to do. All of these matters, they have been well done by him sallallahu alaihi wasallam and well explained by him to everyone. And this is the other component, that we cannot look at the Holy Quran, and the Holy Quran is one of the best things in our life. You cannot understand it, you cannot practice it without the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you should have this combination. And this combination started in the Holy Quran when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, wa ati'u Allah wa ati'u Rasul. And I would rather say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. Whatever is given to you by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you should take it for sure. And whatever he prohibited you of doing it, you should stop doing it. And by this, you look at the greatness. Sometimes you look at the Quran, you have what's detailed in one portion is summarized in another portion. Why? Because we tend in this life to say we are busy, okay? Whenever you are busy, you have a summary, okay? You go by the summary. Whenever you have much more time, you go by the detailed one. That's why you have many of those subjects, you know, mentioned in the Quran. They have been detailed in one side, in one area, and in a summary in another area. Or you may not find it summarized. It's going to be summarized by the prophetic statement. And this is the exception, you know. Usually it's the opposite. It's going to be summarized in the Holy Quran and detailed in the prophetic statement, the prophetic tradition. How great is this Quran? How great is this tradition from him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam highlighted the importance of the first one when he said, مَا مِن نَبِيٍ إلا وقد أوتي من الآيات ما عليه آمن البشر وكان ما أوتيته وحيا فأرجو أن أكون أكثرهم تابعا يوم القيامة. No prophet was sent without being given ayat or signals or miracles, and whatever I was given is this revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I hope, this is the hope of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we are too great when we fulfill the hope of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I hope that I'm going to have the largest number of followers in the hereafter. Why, ya Rasulullah? Because of two factors. The first factor, that this has been kept for us, you know, till Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the permission to have everything, you know, destroyed, you know, for the hereafter. And secondly, because all of your regulation, all of your rules has been summarized in this Holy Quran. And that's why you look at it, how great is it, you know. You look at yourself as a Muslim. You should understand that you have in your religion some basic matters, some essential that shouldn't be given up to anyone. When you hear some people nowadays, you know, out of their benefit or out of politics or out of this or that, they put down some of those bases, you know. You shouldn't listen to such persons, you know. On the other hand, our Islam did not freeze there. If all of it is going to be those unchangeable matter, it's not going to be valid to all times and all people. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on the other hand, gave those flexibilities, those different ideas. And the first one to highlight it was the Quran, when he said, وَلَعَلِمَهُ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَنْبِطُونَهُ مِنْكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made among ourselves, you know, those knowledgeable people, you know, to know how to derive from the Holy Quran, how to derive from the commands of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then make it quite more obvious when he, during the Ghazwat Banu Qurayza, and he gave the command to the people, don't let anyone of you, you know, pray Asr till we reach Bani Qurayza. And some of them, they prayed over their way. They said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam meant only to hurry up, you know, and be fast, you know, and going. The others, they delayed their Asr till they prayed Asr after Isha in Bani Qurayza. The beauty about it, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't blame any of these two. I would rather say he did not show who is more accurate, just to leave room, leave flexibility for difference. And all of us, we should be well oriented in the two aspects. I'm sorry to tell you, some of the Muslims, they are quite stiff, you know, and rigid, you know, and they are not going to change anything, even to a life change, you know, in many aspects, you know. And those, to me, they don't show the flexibility should be shown, you know, for those matters that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left them to be in different aspect and different analysis, you know. And on the other hand, you have, I cannot call them flexible, they are quite wasted, you know, they waste the command of Allah. They try to fool themselves, they try to fool the other by saying, this is what's meant by Allah. They are going to lie on Allah and they are going to lie on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I'm quite sure, even though I did not inspect their hearts, you know, that inside their heart, they know quite sure that they are wrong, you know, about what they have said, but out of politics or out of other factors, they are going to say as such. So to retain back, this is the reality of us. This is our Islam. We should look at it in the both aspect of that special and stable and stationarized and essential matters and the flexible one. We should look at it in another aspect, to what's in the inner and what's in the outer. We should look at it in another aspect for those who are prohibited to be done and those who we are obliged to do. And we should look to it in another aspect, to those who has been mentioned in detail and those who were given as a summary. We should look at it in another aspect, that you have this Holy Quran, which is definite. Okay, even though the meaning may not be definite in many occasions, but it's definite, you know, and has been with full certainty, you know, narrated all over the hundreds and hundreds of years to reach us. And how lucky we are to receive that Holy Quran in this far country, you know, after those hundreds of years, you know, exactly the same the Prophet used to recite it. You know. And we should look in the same time to the prophetic tradition. Some they may feel all the tradition, they are not that confirm, and you have a lot of controversy about it. You are completely wrong. You have this prayer, you have the way you fast, and many of those essential matters in your life, in your religion, in your deen, they are taken all from the prophetic tradition, which made it not only available, well understood and quite obvious. And when you look at it, you have thousands and thousands of people. They said that Zuhr prayer, they are four rak'ahs, you know, from the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and perhaps in our time, not thousands, you have millions and millions of people, you know, they know that Dhuhr prayer is four rak'ahs. And this by itself, you know, give you what has been termed, you know, in according to our scholars, as mutawatir. And this is just a definite matter in your life. And when you look at your life, how many things in your life, they are definite? I am a physician. If I'm asked now, don't practice your medicine, you know, it's except when you have something definite, I'm going to stop work, you know. I'm going to stop right away. And I think most of the practices are such. Perhaps the exception is the mass, which is completely a theory, you know. When you came today to this mosque, you know, you are not quite sure that you are saved. But because this is was the highest probability in your mind, that's why you come. And by this, you are going to look to the greatness of what you have been given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To be definite, to be certain. You have the wording of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to recite it whenever you want. You have the way of facing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whenever you want. You have the way of speaking with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whenever you want. You have the way of have conversation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whenever you want. And you have the way to get the most, the closest position, the nearest position to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whenever you want. Perhaps this is not available when you want to practice it with a humankind. You'll tell you, sorry, I don't have now time for you. Okay, I'm not going to speak with you for this or that, you know. Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His greatness, you know, make this channel, you know, and this way to reach Him, you know, to have your, to find, really I feel shaky now, to find your relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it available to everyone. Some of us, even the tradition of the Prophet ﷺ, they are not eligible, you know, to know it. They have mismatch between them and the Arabic language. They have mismatch between them and the way of understanding. You find it among your children, they are not equal. Some is good at memory, the other one is good at analysis, and the third one is good at something else, you know. You find it in, and because of this difference, you know, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the humanity according to it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made for us, which is that's the third great point, you know, in this Islam, this companion. Who are the companion? According to Sayyidina Mas'ud, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala look at the hearts of all human hearts, and highly selected these to accompany the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this available for you. If you have problem with the Quran, go to the Sunnah. If you have problem with the Sunnah, go to the statement, you know, of the holy companions, you know, radiallahu ta'ala anhum wa an nabihim. These great people, you know, who had this sincerity, they have this heart that I have, I am completely incapable of describing their heart. These students, you know, in the school of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them, you know, available for us. And what did they do? For sure they loved the Prophet much more than us, you know. And the Prophet ﷺ assigned them. Some of them in the life of the Prophet, you go to Syria, the other one go to Egypt. The Prophet ﷺ instructed them where to go, just to establish these schools, you know, of thoughts, these school of sciences, you know, to have them available, you know. When you look at Medina al-Munawwara and those companions who stayed in Medina, you see how great is this school. When you look at Kufa and how Sayyidina Abdullah Mas'ud established that school there, you know, not school of building, you know, and principles and others, no, a school of thought. He established something, you know, which running on, you know, and on for till the hereafter. You see the greatness of them, you know, in this and that. And for some of us, you know, those who even the companions, they don't have the ability to understand them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it much easier for us. And this send these great ulama, you know, we have thousands and thousands of them who try to analyze, try to understand, try to combine all those matters together. To say myself, you know, I'm quite knowledgeable, I don't need anyone, you know. This happened to me, you know. I was reciting Bukhari in one area, you know, and a person came to me asking me, how come the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he prohibited dubba and he used to love dubba? I'm not exaggerating. This is what happened to me. Just all of us, we should know our limit, okay? Don't go beyond your limit. You are not excused. You don't do it, you know, in this life. We only do it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala energy. And I'm sorry to tell you, when we do it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that means we put Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the bottom of our scale, which is completely opposite. It should be the top, the most important thing in your life, your religion. What the meaning of religion? Religion means your relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the answer of that question, I don't want anyone to get confused. The answer to the Prophet ﷺ used to love eating, you know, dubba, but he prohibited dubba of being like a container which may have some alcoholic beverages, you know, in it, inside it or whatever. And when we are too silly, you know, to understand it, this is our problem. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ, when he described his tradition, he said, نَظَّرَ اللَّهُ رَأَى سَمِعَ وَقَالَتِي فَوَعَاهَا فَأَدَّاهَا كَمَا سَمِعَهَا. Okay, firstly you have transmission, secondly you have the understanding. In Arabic we say riwaya and diraya. And to be honest with you, since I have been in this field, you know, diraya is almost zero. We have a lot of riwaya, but we hardly see anyone who is quite, you know how to analyze these matters, you know, about it. And one of those great scholars, you know, is Sayyidina al-Imam al-Nawawi, who really has his significant input, you know, in Shafi'i madhab. Besides that, you know, the whole nation, even the non-Shafi'i, they highly appreciate his work, you know, regarding Riyad al-Salihin al-Adhkar al-Nawawi, which are one of the best books, you know, to get yourself, you know, in touch and in relation with the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then he summarized them in Arba'in al-Nawawiyya, which is going to be held, inshallah, on the coming 2 days, you know, نسأل الله التوفيق. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم. الحمد لله حمد الشاكرين. ويا ربنا لك الحمد شكرا ولك المن فضلا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره المشركون. اللهم صل ولو كره الكافرون. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. ابن عباس عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: بادروا بالأعمال 7، هل تنتظرون إلا فقرا منسيا أو غنى مطغيا أو هرم أو مرضا مفسدا أو هرم مفندا أو موتا مجهزا أو الدجال فشر غائب ينتظر أو الساعة فالساعة أدهى وأمر. عباد الله، إن الله سبحانه وتعالى شرفكم بأن أمركم أن تصلوا على نبيه، فقال سبحانه وتعالى: يا إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد، كما صليت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم، وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد، كما باركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم في العالمين العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. وارض اللهم عن ساداتنا ووالينا الكرام أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن سائر العشرة وعن عمي حبيبك وسبطيه وعن أزواج النبي وأهل بدر وأحد والحديبية وعن سائر المهاجرين والأنصار وأصحاب نبيك وتابعيهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم أصلح أمة سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم فرج الكرب عن أمة سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم اجمع على الهدى أمر أمة سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم اغفر لأمة سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم ارحم أمة سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم رحمة عامة. اللهم أعز أمة سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم انصر أمة سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم اجبر أمة الله.